All right, good morning. Welcome to Fayette Bible Church. So glad to see you here on this beautiful morning as the sun is out. A little crisp outside, but it's going to get warm. So we're just glad that you're here to worship with us this morning. And if this is your very first time here, we want to welcome you. The ushers have a card to give you. Please fill that out. Put that in the offering plate when it's passed. We are glad that you're with us. If you have your order of service, would you look on the back? Just a couple of quick. You saw the announcements, and I like this, that you come in and just take notice of all the announcements there. Every Sunday morning, you'll see things come up there and take note of those, that we won't spend too much time going over those in the service. So hope you're watching that. Make sure you're here for the week's services, Wednesday night, those kind of things. Also, just so you know, deacons, no deacons meeting tonight. No deacons meeting tonight. We'll do that next Sunday evening. So deacons, next Sunday evening, we'll have the deacons meeting. Another one that was up here, but work week at Camp Peniel. That's this week, so it's on us very quickly. If you want to go or would like to go up and help, please see me or Pastor Michael about that. We'll give you some instructions about that, but they can always use help there at Peniel. We have a lot of things coming up. Again, there's sign-up sheets out in the hallway. If you would do this, check those. If you have paid, just make sure I put on there paid. Just make sure I haven't missed you, okay? Because if I missed you, I'll come see you and say, pay me. But so check on that. That's Lacomedia. That's the ladies' perfect friend banquet coming up. All those things are coming up soon. So see that. Mission trip. Continue praying for that mission trip that the Lord would bless and undertake that. Of course, Operation Christmas Child. Again, you see all that here, so I hope you read that and know that. So our theme this morning is a theme that's dear to my heart, the only Savior for mankind. And I hope as we go through the service and we sing and we have communion today, that as we're looking to the Lord, that we realize He is the only Savior for mankind. A lot of this world will trust in all kinds of things, but our sweet Savior is the only Savior for mankind. So as we sing and we do that, may we rejoice together this morning as we worship together in praises to His name. So we will begin as Mark comes and leads us, Wonderful, Merciful Savior. Mark?
Let's go ahead and stand as we sing.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we pray. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we pray. Always hunger.
Continue with the hymn. We sung it a few weeks ago. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can see all is mine, yet not I, but is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. Still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Please read responsively with me from Isaiah 49, verses 25 and 26. Thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away, and the prey of the terrible be delivered. For I will contend with him who contends with you, and I will save your children. I will feed those who oppress you with their own flesh, and they shall be drunk with their own blood as with sweet wine. All flesh shall know that I, the Lord, am your Savior and your Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. Let us pray this morning. Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have to gather together, to live in light of a resurrection that we get to taste even in these days, this side of death, Father. And we are grateful that in Christ we need not fear the second, the great, the final death, for we've been delivered from life unto life in him. This is the resurrection hope that we celebrated last week, and it orients us in this living, that we not live in an earthly way, but Father, that we would look to what is ultimate, what is true, what is liberating in Christ. And Father, we gather today in his name, and we're grateful that he is our Savior. There is no other option, Father, and I pray that we, as people who've been transformed in this truth, perhaps, Father, there's here some with us even today who have yet to taste of Christ and to know of the freedom from sin and from death. Father, I pray that they would see today, they would witness Christ at work in your church people here, that they would testify, that we would testify to them and to others, Father, of life abundant, of freedom from sin. And Father, that we even today, as we in a few moments rehearse the gospel and the ordinance of communion, we would be people with the gospel on our lips and lived out in our deeds. So we ask, Father, as we gather and even now as the plate is passed, as there's an opportunity to give, that we would be blessed as we offer to you that which you've given to us and you've entrusted to us to be careful with for both ministry here and abroad. May we be wise and may we be grateful and cheerful and as we give ourselves to this opportunity even now. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Let's stand as we sing the doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Beginning of every month, we as a church have set aside time in each service to remember our Lord's passion for us. Now, we just did this really in the last several weeks as we considered Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday. We had a Good Friday service. But it's good that we keep this ever before us. And we do so with one of the two ordinances of the church. This is really the continuing ordinance, the one that we continue regularly to bring before us of the Lord's table, the Lord's supper, as we call it. As we were reading in Isaiah 49 just a little bit ago, that those first couple verses, really verse 25 and then the first part of 26, brings a really troubling reality that the wrath of God is upon the sinner. And yet, at the end, there is a declaration that there is hope for those who are God's people, those who have turned from being an enemy of God to now being a part of His family, His people. They are saved. And really, as we come to communion, this is a reality that we're meant to keep before us. And as I look at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says in verse 26, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till He comes." Now, we might think, well, why don't we think about the resurrection here? Well, because the breaking of the body of Christ, not His bones, but like the crushing of the Son under the wrath of the Father and the spilling of His blood on our behalf demonstrates the great cost. That without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sin. What cost? That the God of the universe Himself, who we are saved from His wrath, He Himself saves us unto Himself. The one who is we were enemies against, has sought to make us His friend, His very children. This is because of the death of Christ. It's a gruesome reality, as we've recounted these last couple weeks. And so it's a time for us to consider our own standing before the Lord. This is an opportunity for all who are in Christ. I welcome you. I invite you to come and partake and to be renewed in your thinking of the love of Christ, the love of God to us in Christ, that saves us from sin. And if you're here today and you're visiting and you are in Christ, we welcome you as well to come. But if you're here today and you've never partaken of Christ in faith, if you've never turned back from your sin and looked to Him in faith as your Savior, then we ask you not to partake of these things. There's no sort of ritualistic or magical sort of occurrence that happens when you partake of these things. These are memorials. These depict for us what has already been done for us in Christ. And so we ask of you today, would you partake of Christ in faith? So as the men come, I pray that we have a few moments here to prepare our hearts as we think of the death of Christ on our behalf.
instructions. And he says this in verse 23, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Mr. Paul Cliffs, would you pray that we would remember the Lord's blood spilled on our behalf and be grateful for its covering of sins and good works?
Heavenly Father, we're surely grateful for your willingness to sacrifice your only begotten Son, totally innocent, fully guilty, as we are. And we just know that the shedding of the innocent divine blood, we will have no removal and remission of sin. And we praise you for it and thank you for it and help us to ever remember that we are indeed bought with a price. In Jesus' name. Crucifixion of Christ, as he
cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. It's customary to then sing a song or hymn of fellowship and communion, as was even depicted by the disciples as they departed from that upper room, not completely understanding what was going to take place, though the Lord certainly had laid the pieces out before them so that when the timing was right, the resurrection would have occurred, they would see and they would believe. And that's the prayer today as we partake of this. We would be encouraged in our faith of Jesus Christ, a risen Savior, and yet a full sacrifice in our behalf. So we'll sing as the members carry the cups, hymn 407, "All the Way My Savior Leads Me, What Am I to Ask Beside Me?"
All the way my Savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. All the way my Savior leads me, cheers each winding path I tread, gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. Though my weary steps may falter, and my soul athirst may be, gushing from the rock before me, though a spring of joy I see, gushing from the rock before me, lo, a spring of joy I see. All the way my Savior leads me, oh, the fullness of his love, perfect rest to me is promised in my Father's house above. When my spirit clothed immortal wings its flight to realms of day, this my song through endless ages, Jesus led me all the way. This my song through endless ages, Jesus led me all the way.
I feared is the way he has set, and I long to give in and retreat. Still to Jesus I hold as I face every step, for the Lord he will give me his peace. Bless the Lord, he will give me his peace. Bless the Lord, he will give me his peace. And if I should remain in the valley today, bless the Lord, he will give me his peace. When the road that I tread fills my heart with despair, and it seems that my grief has no end, still to Jesus I hold, who will walk with me there, and the Lord, he will give me his strength. Bless the Lord, he will give me his strength. Bless the Lord, he will give me his strength. And if I should remain in the valley today, bless the Lord, he will give me his strength. On the road that you walked with the weight of the cross, all the pain and my sorrow you held. So to you I shall hold, you redeem every loss, for my Lord you have given yourself. Bless the Lord, for he gives me himself. Bless the Lord, for he gives me himself. And if I should remain in the valley today, bless the Lord, he will give me himself. Bless the Lord, for he gives me himself. Bless the Lord, for he gives me himself. And if I should remain in the valley today, bless the Lord, for he gives me himself. Bless the Lord, for he gives me himself.
Would you pray with me this morning? Father, though you may have us in the valley of trial, and even today as we, in the first hour in this room, we considered resurrection, the before and the after of that, those 3 days of agony for some, of unbelief, of fear, of cowardice, Father, may we look to new life and hope, so that in the dark times, in the low times, in the difficult times, we know that you give us strength, a strength that is unlike any that the world can offer us, any sort of emotional support that even well-meaning friends might seek to offer us. Father, our confidence has to be ultimately in you and you alone. We think of this especially as we recount the trial of Job and even well-intending friends and on his behalf seeking to sort out what it is that could be plaguing him. And, of course, Father, we as readers have a bit of a background, a backstage pass on what is going on there. And yet, Father, we see Job's faith deepened, broadened, affirmed, and really growing because of the valley. And so, Father, we pray for seasons of blessing and of peace and of rest and comfort, and you have surely promised those for us, Father. But in this life, we will face a trial. We will labor And often, as we'll see in our text today, even as it says, we will suffer reproach for the calling that you've placed upon us as your people. So may we be encouraged in Christ that we have not been called to a ministry that is lonely, but our Savior has gone before us. And we even step in line one with another as a family. We are not alone, Father. So I pray that in the valleys and even in the high times of life, as we celebrate things together, and we ought to, Father, as we rejoice in what is good and beautiful in this world, that we would do so grateful to be a part of your people. For in Christ and as a part of his people, we have life and life abundance. Father, I pray that you bless us today as we consider your word, and that even now you would remove from our minds things that would distract or detract even from you speaking to your people through your word. I pray that you would give clarity as I seek to provide the text to your people to feast upon today. May they see Jesus, and may they celebrate the realities of the ministry you've called each and every one of us to as we live in light of Christ. And I pray that you'd bless us as we go from this place, and even tomorrow as we celebrate your handiwork and creation, and we just stand in awe of order and precision to where we can even count the days and the hours and the minutes to see such a spectacle as a total eclipse, right even local to where you've placed us here, Father, that we would glorify your name, for you are a mighty creator, and your great creation of making a new life in us in Christ is far even better than the first creation. So we're grateful for this in Christ. We pray it all in his name. Amen. Turn in your Bible, if you would, to 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I do hope you have a fun time tomorrow. I don't know how many of you are interested in total solar eclipses. From what I hear, it's not too often that these things occur, but I do hope we do look up and we enjoy the beauty of creation, and we find a God of order, a God who's very present and real, and we can count the days of his goodness, even as every day leads to another. We're in 1 Timothy chapter 4. It's been a few weeks since we were here, as we've had, of course, the holiday weekend, the last two Sundays, and I think it's good that we take a break from other series to devote ourselves to the passion of our Savior, even as we've recounted that already in the service with the ordinance of communion. We find his sacrifice in our behalf and of his resurrection. And I hope that we don't merely assent to those things as like kind of a truth that, oh, we got to remember that once or twice a year for a certain holiday. And that's exactly why we try to keep the Lord's table regular to us. Really, in fact, there's some churches that practice that every single Sunday. And then I think the rule of thumb, so to speak, from Scripture is that we do it more often than not. That we ever keep before us the suffering of Christ on our behalf and the fact that he is no longer dead, but yes, the tomb is empty. He is risen, and we are risen in him. And that's the heart of the Apostle Paul. As he writes into the life of first century believers, but he's also writing to you and I today, millennia past. And he's writing that people would be fixed on this gospel. He writes in 1 Timothy, as we've seen so far already, this young elder pastor, his spiritual son of the faith, Paul writes to him, and yet he's writing beyond him as well to a congregation that seems to have shifted, and many at least in this congregation have shifted from the true gospel of Jesus into pointless and divisive trends and topics and discussions. And that brings us to our text today. We turn now to the second half of really this letter. I'll read verses 1 through 5 as well, but our text today is verses 6 through 10. Verse 1 of chapter 4 says this: Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. And again, this is to say that everything has its rightful place according to God's design, friends. Verse 6, if you, Timothy, instruct the brethren in these things, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you have carefully followed. But reject profane and old wives' fables and exercise yourself toward godliness. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. For to this end we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those who believe. This is the word of the Lord. May it be a blessing to us as we receive it today. Friends, as I read verses 1 through 5, I think it's good for us to remember, as we had a few weeks ago, this reality check that we are living in what Paul describes here as these latter days, this period, this indefinite time of leading up to the real imminent return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's a time in which the Christian message must be defended against all the attacks and the craftiness of the devil. And yet, we see here how I think we often can give Satan too much credit. Yes, the realities of spiritual warfare and of devilish deceit are very real and a present danger. They're ominous realities. Verses 1 through 5 almost makes you just cringe to see the words that Paul is saying. The hidden reality behind the dark things that we see in our world today. But it's also true that many churches, I think Ephesus is an example of that, many churches that ought to be strong and mature, and even kind of alluding to what Paul gets to in verse 8, this idea of exercise, they ought to be strong and mature, are often what? Weak and anemic in their faith, having neglected the good work that they had first taken up when they were established as a church. This is the case for first century Ephesus. And Paul is not the only one who thinks this. If you want to hold your place there, turn with me to the letter of Revelation. We call it the book. It's really a letter, is it not? A letter that we find here, especially in chapter 2, a letter in verse 1, it says, to the angel of the church in Ephesus. This is Jesus, our Lord, speaking. These things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. This is Christ. I know your works, Ephesus, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. And you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. The Lord is commending Ephesus. Nevertheless, verse 4, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Our Lord Jesus is the one, of course, giving this message to Ephesus. And the first love, it seems, that Ephesus has abandoned, often we think as a reference to Christ or to the gospel. But really, within the context here, is referring probably to these first works. Look again at verse 4. He says, "Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first loves." And he goes on, "Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen." What would that be? Repent and do the first works. These first works are described up in the things he commends of this church in verses 2 and 3. What? That they have labored in these works, that they have patience, that they cannot bear those who are evil, and you have tested those who say they're apostles and are not and have found them liars. You've persevered and you have patience and not labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. I think this speaks exactly to the very context in which the Apostle Paul is writing into Ephesus. He's speaking into a congregation that is having to do battle, spiritual battle with false accusations of gospels and false teachers and divisive teachings. The first love is the first works they're described and they're called to. The things that they came around, this focusing on the gospel and contending for what is true amidst a very dark time, an oppressive time. The consequences of this failure on the part of the church of giving themselves to the first works is for Christ, not Satan sneaking in and let having his way, but Christ himself voiding the church's status as a church. He says he will remove their candle. And so it goes without saying, you can turn back to 1 Timothy 4, it goes without saying that Ephesus seems to be continuously under the microscope for us in our New Testaments, is it not? And I wonder if Ephesus really finally got the message, and if we in the American church today have gotten the message as well. My professor at Cedarville, Dr. Michael Shepherd, said this last week. We get to read their mail, friends. The letters of the churches in Revelation chapter 2 are meant for our edification as well. And the question is what kind of ministry are we about? What is the American church all about, brothers and sisters? Well, as Paul continues in our text today, as we look at verses 6 through 10 of 1 Timothy 4, we come to see even more clearly how synonymous, how similar, how the same, really, Christian ministry is with word ministry. Do we see these things together? If I was to ask you, what is Christian ministry? What would we define it as? I think a lot of different churches in our very city, in our region, in our nation, there'd be a lot of different ways which people would describe what we call quote unquote Christian ministry. But friends, we see here from the apostles that the focal point of Christian ministry rises and falls on the ministry of the word. We looked at this last week, did we not? Even in John's gospel in chapter 20, as we considered the resurrection and the testimony of a risen Savior, that the writings of the gospel are for our edification. Friends, what you do in this life as a Christian minister comes down to what you will do with the word of God. There's certainly a lot of good Christian parachurch sort of organizations that do a lot of humanitarian things, and those are good things, but we can see even the unsaved world give themselves to such things. The thing that makes Christian ministry distinct, friends, is that we believe in the truth and the power of this book. Are we ministers of the word? And so this is the main idea of the message for us today, friends. Christian ministry is word ministry, and that is the making and maturing of believers in godliness by the word. We begin by thinking about the role of really the individual believer in the context of the church. Paul, in our passages, of course, writing to Timothy, and he directs Timothy about what it is to be, first of all, a good minister. Look with me again at verse 6. If you instruct the brethren in these things, we'll look at that, what he's referring to there in just a minute, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you have carefully followed. In order to fully appreciate verse 6, we need to figure out what it is that is meant by Paul's reference to these things. What are these things Timothy is exhorted to instruct the church in? Well, the answer, as you probably can put it together, is found in verses 1 through 5. Timothy, and any good minister, for that matter, is to expose the deceitful teachings of those who depart from the faith, as we see in verses 1 through 5. At the forefront of Paul's mind is addressing the lies about the goodness of God's creation. We saw that 3 weeks ago as we walked through verses 1 through 5. These good things that God has created, the institution of marriage, the eating of good food. These things that, again, all things finding their appropriate place within God's design are things to be enjoyed. And yet there was this sort of schism, there's this other doxy, this other teaching, this false doctrine that seemed to make the material world as completely evil. And so there's some sort of religious piety to doing away with material things, to even deny our bodies and whatnot. And Paul says that is out of step with the true gospel. That really the Lord is restoring a very physical world and reality unto himself. We have here in verse 6 a three-part progression of what makes a good minister and therefore a good ministry. And I think this is the message for us to consider. Not just to kind of look back on Ephesus, how they ought to better fine-tune their ministry, but how we can be missional and on point with what we're called to be as a church. What it is to be a good ministry or a minister, a congregation of good ministers together. Paul presents this progression, though, in reverse through the text. So working backwards through verse 6, we see that a good minister and a good ministry begins, first of all, with elders who are careful in following the good doctrine. It begins with the leaders, and Paul, again, writing to really his apostolic envoy to this church in Ephesus. Timothy is really playing the role of an elder among other elders. And as we've seen already, many of these elders are unqualified. And so Timothy, even a younger man amongst probably older men, is having to seek to reorient the church to its first love, back to these works. And it begins what? It begins where? It begins with those people, these leaders, with the individual believer, even, giving themselves to the good doctrine. Now, what is the good doctrine? This is, of course, the teachings of Christianity. The points of theology, it's the biblical theology, the rethinking of all of life according to the message of this book. The Bible is not simply a reference guide with tips for you. It is meant to conform our entire way of thinking and living. And it begins by a careful devotedness to the text. This, of course, complements what we've seen so far as we looked at the offices of the elder and of the deacon and the high regard and the guarding of the ministry of the word, the study of the word by elders. The good minister is, first of all, to be careful to follow the good doctrine. Secondly, we see here in verse 6 that the good minister is nourished in the words of faith, the daily renewal of the gospel. Being renewed in fresh mercy. So it's not just simply some theology like textbook that we just simply read, but actually that we are nourished. We're actually transformed in that and how we live and move and interact with one another. It's not just something we assent to. It's not just simply a statement that we just say, yeah, I'm good with that. But it's actually a reality that changes us. It works in us repentance. It calls us to hunger and thirst for mercy and to know that we can find fresh mercy in Christ every day because God's mercy never ends, friends. And then thirdly, where does this lead to? It means that the good minister, having carefully followed the good doctrine, having been nourished in the words of faith, then that spills out. He instructs others accordingly. Christian ministry is not just simply about man himself, like the individuals. What you come here for, hopefully, is so that what you receive here channels through you, both in this, the people in this room, in this following minutes after this hour, but also throughout your entire week. We're meant to be a pitcher in which we are poured into and then we pour out into other people. This is what the good minister does, as Paul writes here, right? If you instruct, and that's the last part here, if you instruct the brethren in these things, and again, the things of contending for the true faith amidst a generation, against a dark age in which there's a lot of your truths, you just do your truth, and we'll give you a space to have your truth, and you, that's good for you, and this person can have theirs. No, no, no. This is contending for the ultimate truth, the one reality of God's word, the truth of God's word. We're to be careful to instruct others in this, having been nourished in it ourselves and having been careful to follow in the straight and narrow way, the teaching of Christ. Really, this is, of course, something for all people, but we typically think, especially here, as we find Paul writing to Timothy, that this must be true of pastors and teachers and elders. And I would say myself, I stand as a product of this kind of ministry. A ministry that other people have had into me. It's been a long, long line of faithful men and women for all 33 years of my life who have channeled the good doctrine of the Christian faith into my life. I'm speaking to several of you today. It's completely shaped me. It's set my life on a very unique trajectory. It started at my home. With my parents, who discipline themselves and their schedule to prioritize the church for their children. They served in nursery. They did their time in Tiny Tots. Some of you maybe recall Tiny Tots. But I also had Sunday school teachers like Mrs. Polly McClish, and Mr. Dan Larson, Dr. David Rosado, three special people who distinctly stand out in my life and my memory, who sacrificially, week after week, committed to faithfully show up and teach me and my siblings and my friends from Bible lessons. You don't have to be perfect to do that. You need to be oriented, as we see here, committed to the Christian doctrine, to be nourished yourself in the faith, and to be willing to spill it out into other people. I had a pastor who many times each week, both here and in a Christian school that many of us know well, would draw, as he did, from a very exhausted heart to preach and to teach the Bible. And he was the first of a long line of men I would call my pastors. Others like men such as Chuck Bonnities, Chuck Phelps, Tom Kaufman, Eric Sipe, David Saxton. And though there wasn't a clear moment in my sitting under their preaching ministry, but there was this sort of gradual transitioning in which it wasn't just simply standing under their preaching, but standing then alongside them in ministry. As I was nourished by the words of the faith, I became a co-laborer along with them, and that's how it ought to be, not just for preacher boys, but for all of us, friends. This is how it ought to be for each and every believer in this room. Are you disciplining yourself? Are you giving yourself to the calling of co-laborship? Coming alongside, standing alongside ministers of the word? That you yourself would find yourself to be a minister of that word. We're each called to carefully follow the good doctrine, as the text says here. And we each are to be nourished in the word of faith so that as we are able, even as maybe we don't want to, but we're called to, we are to instruct others accordingly. Now, Paul, again, might be writing to Timothy as an acting elder there in Ephesus, but the first thing we need to recognize here is that this is a calling not just for people in the ministry. This sort of work may be expected to start among church leaders, but it's meant to trickle down through discipleship so that such progress becomes each member, so that everybody develops in this way. That every member of the heavenly household on earth has a ministry, a distinctly Christian ministry. Ephesians 4, verse 12, Ephesians comes up again. Paul says what? The work of the leaders in your church is to do what? To equip the saints for the work of the ministry. That's not just, you know, some sort of, I wonder what that ministry could look like. It's Christian ministry. It's word ministry for the edifying of the body of Christ. All believers, friends, this is the application for us as we start. All believers have been thrust into this ministry. This is the calling we all have. Think of Matthew 28 and the Great Commission. Don't just think that means like the uttermost parts in relationship to where you stand. Friends, we live in the uttermost parts of the earth. Are we doing this ministry? The question that brings this home then is this. Who are you discipling? Who are you discipling? Who are you, if that word is kind of ambiguous, who are you helping follow after Jesus through thoughtful teaching from your Bible? This is the great calling for all of us. And I hope it doesn't strike you as a mundane task. Friends, it does take work. It is difficult tasks. It's a difficult task. But friends, it is a worthy calling. It's matchless in its value. That's the point Paul's getting to as we continue down in our text. Is there's others who would simply like to strive in material ways and in bodily ways, and thinks that can, and it certainly has maybe a place in some instances. But Paul makes a comparison that developing and drawing godliness out in the next generation or amongst your own is actually something of far superior value. I don't think there's a single true believer who isn't compelled forward in their Christian walk by the desire of hearing these words we often read, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," on the day that we enter into the rest of the Lord. Well, my friend, the Apostle Paul keys you and me into the kind of life that warrants the pleasure of God. And it's this word ministry, one with another. Because it's a battle. Look again, think of the context of verses 1 through 5, the deceit of our age, the lies of the devil, and how they even find their ways into such places and gatherings as we would have here. We must be on watch. We must be doing this one to another. But we press on. In verses 7 through 9, we find, secondly, in another element of Christian ministry is the faithful saying. Look at verses 7 through 9. "But reject profane and old wives' fables, and exercise yourself toward godliness." He makes a contrast to what we ought to be doing, not to fall into what evidently is taking place in Ephesus and is the threat of the church at large. Because he says in verse 8, "For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come." This, that, my friend, is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. These verses show us that there is an enduring, eternal wealth in the imperceivable, the things we don't see, the invisible things of God, the things that God is doing that we can't put our hands on, the work he's doing in our hearts through the ministry of the word. So friends, the content, if we could say the business that we give ourselves to at church ought to be the word of faith. This is the content. This is what we do. It's a spoken ministry. We don't gather to simply look at relics or cool pictures. We don't gather for the aesthetics of religion or even for physical exercises, as we see described here. That's probably as much as people who are out of weight like to look at this text and look at everybody else who's fit and kind of feel a little bit self-righteous, right? None of us have done that, right? But this is really probably more talking about making a reference to the group who were denouncing marriage and of eating bread. The false teachers were viewing religious ministry as primarily an issue of bodily activities, legalistic do's and don'ts. And so whereas the good minister is spiritually nurtured, Christian ministry leads to godliness, something noted as having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come, over and against, that stands over and against all these vain fables. And as we remember from chapter 1, the pointless discussions, the genealogies, and these, as we see described here, these bodily exercises of religion. Paul directs us to that which is ultimate, never failing, nor fading. And I think the illustration helps us, right? If you've ever tried to work out, I'm not really a gym guy. I like to run, and some of you are the other way around, right? I like to run and to cycle on a bike. There was a few months where I was faithful to a schedule of going to the gym, and it was the few months leading up to my wedding. And after that, it all just fell apart, right? And it's like you can put so much time and effort. You can try to sculpt yourself through such exercise, but we feel the reality that we find in the text here. That stuff does not last, does it? It's always a striving after that. That's not to say that that's pointless or that it's really that we ought not to take care of ourselves physically, but the point I think to be made is what is ultimate beyond that? We live still, friends, with the reality of the first death before all of us, unless the Lord brings us home. And so what are we committing ourselves to in this life? Is it the bodily, the material, or are we thinking about that which is ultimate? Are we living for heaven, as it's been called, as we live upon the earth? Paul directs us to that which is never failing nor fading, that which is immaterial and yet ever profitable, true godliness. This is a truth, as he says in verse 9, that you can take to the bank, friends. It's worth it. You don't get the gratification of having a trophy, of having the money, the material stuff in your hands. But friends, there is nothing quite like walking alongside a brother and a sister and seeing them benefited or blessed or somehow nourished by some influence you had, and just simply being a channel of God's grace into their life. You can't put a price tag on that. It's immaterial, but friends, it is worthy. And if you've ever been ministered to, if you've ever been ministered to in such a way, you know it. This is the truth that we can take to the bank. And these verses call us then to beware of any sort of Christian hedonism. And that word hedonism, it's talking about that which only brings personal pleasure, in which we make Christianity out to try to make us have a comfortable life. This sort of living, though perhaps not intentional, ultimately sees the gospel as the key to the happy life. Pleasure in this world, again, very temporary and bodily, not focused on the ultimate and eternal quality of growing in Christ through the ministry of the word and of faith. Kostenberger, a well-written commentator, says this: Paul's words remain relevant today in a world where many indulge in self-centered hedonism, an egregious or not so egregious materialism. And then he recalls something Paul has brought up already that we've seen. Just as women should refrain from obsessive attention to their outward appearance, donning elaborate hairstyles and jewelry, as we saw in chapter 2, verses 9 through 10, men should avoid undue preoccupation with body sculpting in modern day fitness centers. Both extremes can distract and detract from the heavenly calling we've all been called to. It's a battle of our mind in many ways, and of our hearts, of where we will place true value, where we recognize really where true value is. But then we press on finally here to verse 10 as we close. And we consider in Christian ministry, there is no Christian ministry. There is no word ministry if we do not have the word himself who became flesh and saved us from our sins. We're meant to look then and point all people to our wonderful Savior. What a theme we've had today. And so let us consider the Savior of all people. Look again with me at verse 10. For to this end of making disciples, we both labor and suffer reproach. It's not all glitz and glory in this life. Because why? We trust in the living God that his word is true, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those who believe. These things, as verse 11, as we'll pick up next time, these things command and teach. Friends, this final point emerges as a voice of confidence against what our materialistic, comfort-seeking hearts would otherwise say. Friends, we need a verse like verse 10 because it is very tempting. And I feel it. You probably do too. It's very tempting to pursue the easy life on this side of eternity, to tap the brakes on living for heaven when we have so many wonderful things here and now to enjoy. Who needs to labor and suffer reproach, as he says here, when we can live so comfortably, so long as we don't engage with our neighbors or the culture with the gospel? Friends, if you don't want conflict, don't ever talk about Jesus Christ. That's not the hope of the Savior of all people going to the uttermost parts of the earth, because that's why Paul brings in what he does next. And I don't want anyone to be confused by what he's saying here. It's not teaching universalism, that is, well, Jesus saved everybody, so we don't got to worry about this. No, it's saying that Jesus is the one Savior for all people. He's the only option, is what this is saying. And only those who believe, as he continues on in that verse, only God's chosen people, those who have faith in Jesus, will experience this salvation. This world, friends, wants to derail you from living with this message. It will reject that message. It already has. It wants to derail you also from living on mission of making and knowing the living God who is the Savior of all men, and from making other disciples who would follow after him. So the application for us as we consider then is, are we willing today to give up a lot of things in life so as to live on mission? To be faithful to the Christian teaching, to the word of faith, to be found faithful in teaching others accordingly. What needs to change, friends, for you to live and labor on mission? Well, friends, I think it starts with your own personal study of the Word. That's exactly how Paul begins. The Christian minister, a good minister, understands it. Look again at verse 6. He is one who has carefully followed the good doctrine. He's also one who is nourished in the words of faith. And it's out of that that you instruct the brethren. You reach out to those around. Friends, are you living on mission? Does what you think of a Christian ministry amount to word ministry? The studying of the Bible together with others. Friends, we are surrounded by so many in this world who are being led astray by material wealth and bodily exercise. Have we set, in our church here, have we set a model of godliness? Are we nourishing others in the word of faith so that they would experience salvation in Christ alone? What needs to change in your life for you to live and labor on mission? And would you be willing to be discipled? Maybe this draws out of some of you an awareness of just like, I don't think I could do that. This is the calling before all of us, friends. That's what this gathering is for, that we would come together, be edified, so that we can edify one another, and we can go out from here equipped to do the work of the ministry. Are we doing that? Are you willing to be discipled? And would you be willing to disciple someone? This is why I make, it seems, endless appeals for our small group times that take place on Wednesday night. And I would also say for our Sunday school hour on Sunday morning. What wonderful times of really kind of rubbing shoulders together as we interact with questions and discussions about the Word, friends. Would you be discipled? Could you make time for that? Would you disciple someone else? Could you make time for that? Would you be interested in learning how to maybe be involved in a Bible study? So, friends, maybe it begins with some of you simply disciplining yourself and your family and your schedule to make time for such things as the gathering of this body, more than just simply coming and receiving kind of a one-way discipleship from the pulpit, but actually coming and locking arms with one or two other people and being edified in the Word. Friends, this is, I hope it's not a heavy thing upon you. It ought to be a joy. It's my joy, and it's the joy of Paul as he writes the other churches in the first century. His joy is that they would be complete in the faith and unwavering. Let us pray and ask the Lord to give us this vision. Father, we thank you for today. And I pray that your people have been edified, that they've seen really the progress you've called them to of being rooted in the Christian teaching. And that from that, Father, they themselves would be nourished in the word of faith, in the gospel, that they would see that living a life of repentance and being daily oriented and on your mercy that never ends and being renewed in the newness of Christ, that would free them, Father, from maybe being afraid that they're not good enough to do certain things like this, that they don't have a capacity to do simple edification one to another. But Father, I pray, Father, that you would awaken in this congregation a hunger and a thirst for discipleship, that we would see people in the Word together, that we not settle for humanitarian efforts and good things, but Father, that we would truly see Christian ministry as word ministry, for only in your word do we find the risen Christ. And so I pray that we would be set on him and we'd be edified in it today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand as we close in hymn 799? Just three verses here, the first, the second, and the fifth. You have it there in your order of worship. May the mind of Christ, my Savior, live in me from day to day.
Savior, live in me from day to day. By his love and power controlling all I do and say. May the word of God enrich me with his truth from hour to hour, so
his letter and saying this, brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. Friends, what a Christian ministry we have set before us one to another. I pray to see you out tonight as we gather again around the word to be edified in what is true. Blessings as you go from here. Hope to see you tonight and Wednesday.